We are the painters of our world. We are creators. We decide what.
Thank you all for being here today. Let's dive right into it. We'll start with you, Dr. Weber. What is Brown versus Board of Education? Why is it so important and relevant in today's society?
Well, thank you for the question. And I think Brown versus Board of Education has been 70 years now since it became law in the nation. And I think it was significant because it addressed the issue of what separation does to people. You know, racism, what it does to people. It's not just a small thing. It affects not only physical, but emotional, economic elements that are there. And so when we looked at Brown versus Board of Education, when it first came out, everyone was ecstatic because they thought it would basically address all of our issues at one time through the educational lens. We've learned since then that it's been a mixed bag. There have been some things that we look at that we think are really wonderful. And then we see the disintegration of a lot of things that were important to us. Black education, curriculum that's there, what happened to Black teachers and administrators in Southern states. You know, the focus was taken away from the academic excellence and became the social issue. Mm-hmm. And then when I look at where we are now, 70 years later, I'm not sure if it even addressed the social issues. Mm-hmm. When we see the hatred and the things that occur in our society, mm-hmm. I thought having integrated our schools, and doing that work, that in itself would change the generations. And yet we're seeing those who are from that generation and their children from that generation still wrestling with a lot of the issues of race and equity and those kinds of things, and a lack of understanding of African Americans in the nation. So it's a mixed bag. It got us to a point where we thought we'd made some headways and victories in terms of at least getting a legal decision about racism and separation. But it took away so many other things because it didn't do the comprehensive work that needed to be done to really transform the nation.
Absolutely. You mentioned those elements of the social integration. I'm going to Trustee Haynes. You kind of lived through that. Can you kind of illustrate some of your experiences with that?
Yes. So in 1954, I was 9 years old, and our family had a TV, an unusual thing for a Black family in a neighborhood. And so for me, it was seeing what was happening in terms of desegregation on the television from California. And I'm going to fast forward. I go off to high school in 1960, and it was pivotal. It was a Catholic high school, all girls in Los Angeles, St. Mary's Academy, and 24 Black young women crossed the threshold for the very first time. In the sophomore class, there was one Black student. In the senior class, there was one Black student. And so 24 of us, and today I can still name those girls. But there was still separation. We were able to cross the threshold and we benefited from it. We were prepared for it. But so many of our students were not. That is still the dilemma.
And to piggyback off that dilemma, Dr. Clark, I'll turn it over to you. What impact has it had on today's educational system, particularly in K-12? Dr. Weber mentioned the integration of the folks, but not the teachers, the students, but not the curriculum, and the impact that it had on sense of belonging.
There's often a stigma that is that follows our schools that are heavily minority. And that stigma comes from when you see Black and brown students, there is an automatic perception of low achievement, of low expectations or whatnot. And so as a result of Brown, the resources are there on a foundational level. Communities have found ways to fund their schools in different ways so that we still see those economic gaps in our schools. And so, you know, just to get back to it, although our schools have legal integration, they still are extremely segregated, in our populations and in our staffing. And so these are things that we still see and we still struggle with. And I would say probably the biggest impact of that is expectations and mindset on what students of color can produce.
If I can build off, I think a couple of the thoughts shared. I mean, one of the premises around Brown versus Board wasn't just integration. It was around fair access to resources. Separate and unequal really was the law of the land. And so you had not only school segregation, but you had dilapidated facilities, overused school books, supply. So Black schools at that time were struggling. And so, of course, you want to be able to get access to greater level of resources. But we still find till this day that our schools are still segregated and there's still huge disparities in resources. When you look at Jonathan Kozol's book, Savage Inequalities, it point out that you still have huge disparities. When you look at resources of schools that serve predominantly African-American students. And so I think still some of the initial premise around Brown versus Board of Education is still pertinent in terms of looking at the disparities of resources that exist in our K-12 systems right now.
Absolutely. I think you all mentioned the structural and systemic and systematic inequities that still have impacted truly integrating and having equal access to resources, the way they're funded, the way they're allocated, the way they're advocated for. We see a lot happening right now with affirmative action. We see a lot with the diversity, equity, inclusion initiatives. I'm going to turn it over to you, Dr. Wood. What are the realities and experiences, particularly in higher education, of how are people trying to augment some of these resources to compensate for the true enactment of Brown versus Board?
Yeah, I mean, well, part of the reason that Brown versus Board had unintended consequences is like Dr. Bush is saying, right? The resources were unequal. And people wanted to have access to a higher quality of education. But the interpretation that really came out was that Black teachers, Black school, Black curriculum was not as good. And so, like Dr. Weber said, there had an impact on teachers. What happened is that the teaching force, the Black teaching force, was devastated after Brown versus the Board of Education because the interpretation was they must not be good enough. So we didn't integrate. We integrated students, we didn't integrate teachers, right? So what happened is we had a significant loss of the Black teaching force. Now, how higher education has tried to adjust to that is by being really proactive and trying to be thoughtful about how we diversify our faculty. The truth is, though, in higher education in K-12, our faculty are not even close to being representative of the students that they serve. And so, you know, a lot of institutions have focused on what are some strategies that we can do to get there. Our students deserve to be in classrooms where they're treated with dignity, where they're treated with respect, where they have educators who care about them and have high expectations for their performance. And too often, that's just not the case.
Absolutely. I think recruitment is one thing, retention is another. Access is one, support and success is another. So getting them in the door is one aspect of the charge, but keeping them in there is important. So to that point, I'm going to turn it over to you, Dr. Bush, and then come to you, Dr. Weber, on this one. You've seen the attacks on diversity, equity, inclusion. You've seen the attacks of just trying to have any type of equity work being advanced. Where are we now in the context of higher education, and how does that impact you as a leader?
Well, the impact is tremendous. So we have in a pull back before we ever arrived. So the assumption is that great advancements have been made and that we no longer need, and just fill in the blanks. We no longer need affirmative action. We no longer need a critical analysis of race and history in this country. We no longer need to talk about equity and inclusion because somehow things are all of a sudden became fair and equitable in this country. And we know that's not the case. And so I think these initiatives are not just an attack on a policy, it's an attack of a people. We can't have this conversation without talking about power and the relationship of power, because these policies are fundamentally about maintaining power, concentrating power in the hands of those who have always ruled this country. And so it's a constant battle. And so the response for us has to be always to push forward, not to just be relying on a system that has already set up structures of oppression to educate our children, that we have to have conversations about how to form independent Black institutions, how to create Black spaces and white places so it could build a sense of community, so our expertise can flourish. It's one thing to have representation and retention, but it's another thing to be able to flourish by being able to still be Black in those spaces, to talk about Black curriculum, to talk about things that's pertinent to the Black community. So we can have Black teachers in a K-12 system still teaching the same curriculum that anyone would teach, regardless of how they look.
Yeah, I appreciate everything you said. It's so true. I almost said amen, but I was told I can't talk in the middle of other folks, so I just decided to hold my amen to myself. But amen, okay, what you were saying. You know, having been in this field for over 50 years now, and having fought most of the battles that people talk about, whether it's at the university or whether it's in the K-12 system or whatever, you come to the realization that there is no intent really to educate Black kids to be competitive with others. That's as a broader concept, because when you start talking about academic excellence, you start talking about accountability, you start talking about changing structures as where teachers teach and don't teach and how you get the best teachers in communities where you have the greatest need. You start talking about that and immediately the whole system caves in on you. You know, you can't do those things. You can't do this because this group, the union group or this group or that group will have their say. And never at the center and core of the conversation is African-American children or children who are failing in this nation. Kids don't get a do-over. They're either going to be successful in school or they're not. And you can't just constantly put it all on them as a responsibility that they should be better, you know, and they should integrate. And those kinds of things. And they have the social responsibility of being the good people that can demonstrate to the world that they're good people when people are mistreating them every day. And so, you know, when I went to school at Holmes Avenue Elementary School in Los Angeles, it was a segregated school. It was in the projects, in the Pueblos. And every teacher in that school was Black, but one. And they had just come from Mississippi and Alabama, and they were no joke when it came to academic excellence for us kids in their projects. Everybody could read, write, do math, do division, taught us algebra. And they taught us that we would have to be twice as good to be considered. Hmm. And they taught us how to deal with racism in a society.
I'm gonna go to you, Dr. Wood, because Dr. Weber unleashed a lot on that piece.
That was powerful.
But the pivot from surviving to thriving, the pivot from institutional accountability as opposed to putting the burden and the locus of control on that student. You've done some dynamic work. Can you talk a little bit and piggyback off that comment of how creating these necessary spaces to uplift, as you mentioned, for Black males, and how you can't just wide scale that sometimes. It has to be customized and curated for that specific cause.
Yeah, I mean, if you think outside of the South, there are no true, you know, historically Black colleges. In California, there is a historically Black graduate institution, but there are no HBCUs for the undergraduate level. And so when I came into Sacramento State, I've been there for about 10 months now, and we have the largest population of Black and African-American students in the entire California State University system. So out of all 23 institutions, no one serves more Black students than we do. And we're proud of that. And at the same time, historically, our success rates with Black students has not been where it should be. And so what I decided to do is work with our campus community to create our own system. And so we basically launched a Black Honors College. So it's an honors college that's specifically designed to serve students who are interested in Black history, life, and culture. And in order to do that, we had to say, we have to make this something separate and something different, because the systems that are in place are so detrimental to progress that even if we put something in place maybe 2-3 years later, we'd be right back to the point where we started. So we set aside 6,000 square feet of space on our campus, in the heart of our campus, in the library. And I picked the library specifically because of the message it sends about learning, because oftentimes we're viewed as being academically inferior. They've got their own seminar room, they have their own office suite, they have their own student center. We've identified 17 faculty members who are on release time, who have a history and a demonstrated record of success in teaching and serving Black students. And we've also basically moved over 8 different staff members. We've got a dean of students, we've got a director. They have their own counselors, their own therapists, their own academic advisors, their own outreach team. So it's its own ecosystem within the institution. And essentially what happens is they come into the campus and they're taking their general education. Their entire general education pathway is taught in the Black Honors College. So, you know, in GE, you got to take a class in history, you got to take a class in writing, got to take a class in math. Imagine each one of those classes being taught from a perspective that values and centers the Black experience and Black people.
What I've heard, and I think it needs to be said, race matters. And no matter what the country says about race, it matters for us to see our own. It matters for us, for those who care, to move the conversation, because we've only sort of skirted this issue around curriculum, making it relevant for our students who do not see themselves reflected either in the classroom or in the curriculum. And that not only starts from the first grade, it goes all the way through our academic and our from high school into our colleges. The benefit of college is that we get to choose our classes. And I think that there are a number of us who learned about ourselves in college, not in high school. For myself, I went to a Catholic school that taught about the popes, that made us create a map of Europe. I didn't learn about me and what my ancestors did until I got to college. And we need to change that trajectory.
Absolutely.
Well, Black Studies makes every attempt to do that, and California is fortunate to have more Black Studies departments and degrees than any other state in the nation. And that is extremely important. And that's one of the reasons why we fight so hard to keep it in all of our campuses. Because I had seen students who come through and on a fluke end up in ethnic studies, white students or whatever, because they couldn't get another class. It transformed their lives. They came back and took more of those. They traveled with us to Africa. They did these things. And now I look at them and they're practicing law and they're better lawyers than some of the others I see because they have a greater sensitivity to the issues that we raised. So it is so important that we do that. And we've done the work initially, but we have to be vigilant. It really is about the history of this country and the people who live here and what they value, what they bring, and how they move forward, and how all of us see ourselves when you learned who you are and where you came from, and how knowing where you are and who you came from makes you a stronger, more determined person than just being a person on a list.
And you mentioned a lot about self-efficacy, self-esteem, self-worth, which actually leads to performance and to success and how we measure success oftentimes. And there's a pattern that I'm noticing here. Whenever there's something that's specific and intentional and deliberate for Black folks, there is this watering down effort, whether it's the Black Male Success Initiative that you mentioned in San Diego, or this ethnic studies, particularly focused on specific folks. I'm gonna turn over to you, Dr. Bush. Why is it so relevant and so important to keep the eye on the prize, to stay laser focused on the populations that we're serving? And can you talk a little bit about your work with AMEND and why it's so specific sometimes? And it's not exclusive, but inclusive to be that laser focused.
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple of thoughts that emerge. One, I think we need to do some level setting really about what the prize actually is and what do we call success and what does that mean and what does that look like for Black students. Often when I'm talking to folks around this topic, I ask two questions. What is it that you want to see for Black people and what is it that you want to see for Black students? To better see how those things, those aspirations is therefore connected to what it is we teach in our school systems. And oftentimes there's a disconnect because when we say what we want for Black students, when we want for Black people, we say we want them to be able to be financially independent. We want them to be able to self-actualize, to be able to solve the problems and conditions that impact the communities in which we come from, that we want to be free, that we want to be sovereign. But then when we begin to operationalize what success means, we say graduation rates, transfer rates, expulsion, suspension. I mean, we look at high school completion, A through G completion. And the question is, what does that have to do with freedom, sovereignty, right? Because we already acknowledged that the curriculum decenters what's important for Black people. And so we don't ever ask the question. We talk about the implications of the lack of success for Black students, but we don't talk about the implications of success. What happens if all of our Black babies really internalize the curriculum that they're being taught? If they really believed it, if they really embraced it, will we be better off? If they totally submitted and bought into a curriculum that reinforces a certain level of inferiority, this idea that you haven't significantly contributed to humanity, that your history started with enslavement. Like, if you really believe this stuff, what will happen? And so I think organizations like AMEND, the Black Honors College, begins to try to re-level set. What are the expectations for our Black children and for our Black students and our Black teachers and our Black administrators? We got to separate education for schooling, because much of what we're talking about is the schooling process and not really defining what education is in the first place. And so we got to build structures and programs that centers Black students' experience. I think we have to build structures and programs that allow students to show it, to feel like they don't have to be someone else to be successful, that their Blackness is normalized, is accepted, that the language that they use is acceptable. And so I think most of our students achieve in spite of instead of because of. And that's the paradigm I think that needs to shift in our schools and our colleges.
Yeah, and if I could just chime in, I think, you know, helping our students be resilient. Mm-hmm. And we talk about lifelong learners. And so often, you know, we spend so much time in our systems of knocking our young people down and telling them no and why they can't do certain things. There just needs to be a sort of process of no, you can do and you can achieve. You can be a contributing member to society, because all of the messages that they see don't support that, right? They're seeing these negative messages in the media, in our curriculum, in just the way that schools are set up. I really try to work with my teachers and administrators on why can't we just accept people where they are and see value in that?
And the benefit to that is not just for Black folks.
Mm-hmm.
It's for everyone. Once they understand, because oftentimes we think that Black studies or Black excellence is beneficial to Black folks, but it's beneficial to everyone. I was across the world and I stood at a stoplight in Dubai in January. And I was talking to my taxi driver from India, and I said, see that light right there? Yeah. That green, yellow, red? Yeah. An African-American man in the United States of America developed that technology. You see that GPS, this Uber that you're utilizing right now? Gladys West, a Black woman, developed mm-hmm. that technology. Mm-hmm. This man, I started going, all the inventions, he talked about his grandma's on a walker. I said, a Black woman developed that technology. So all the contributions of Black folks to the world and the advancement of society oftentimes relegated to just how it's beneficial just to us as Black folks, but no, it benefits everyone. And so that's what Black excellence truly means. And so the self-actualization, the self-realization, going back to racism and race matters, it'll make you less racist if you understand that we're just more than sports players and movie stars and these other initiatives that, you know, folks are always looking at Black success to be at. So I'm going to turn over to you, Trustee Haynes, and you mentioned a bit about college and the access point. How can California community colleges serve as a pivotal role in terms of outlook and future to mitigate some of these concerns? And there's Vision 2030 and other initiatives to answer the bell and access support and success.
I'm glad you asked that question, so thank you for it. I think we're at a pivotal stage. California, it's been said, When we want to do something, we can. And when we do it right, the nation listens and looks toward it. So I think we're in that position now. And Vision 30, its promise is this. Its promise is around moving forward with workforce and economic development and to do it equitably. Now, I'm going to hold, as a board member, I'm going to hold that equity piece. And I'm always going to be looking through it, through the lens, to see if it's actually working. Mm-hmm. Because we don't, here, we're sensitive about talking about race. But when we look at the data, it's usually Black and brown folks who are at the bottom of that scale. And if we're going to be successful, there are 6.8 million Californians who have a high school degree, either with no college or some with some college. So that population. We also have millions of California high school students who we need to sort of push down through dual enrollment relative to workforce and even being able to transfer to a four-year if that's what they want to do. But we really do have to focus in on those who have not been served. That's where equity comes in, because it's talking about resources and pushing money to where it's needed. That's where the Board of Governors comes in. That's where our colleges come in.
The fact that we have a community college, hundreds of them in California, in every location, says that you don't have to leave school, leave home to go to college. You don't have to also break the bank to go to college, because right now the first 2 years are free. Our community college stands in the gap. And I don't think there's a family in California that has not had somebody enrolled in a community college. What we need to do is elevate the community college so that it is just as important to us as the University of California. And the community college takes on the responsibility of not just being the intellectual group, the scholars and those kinds of things that the focus in the UC is so deep on. It does all of that, but it also reaches those students and pulls them up and keeps them close so that they have someone to really be about. And so I think we've been fortunate in California. There's no system like the community college anywhere else. And the community college is an amazing place for so many students who may be able to get into UC, but can't move away. They can't do this. They can't do that. They have other kinds of challenges in their lives. They may be married. They may have children. Community college gets all of those. And so therefore they need to be elevated to a point that we celebrate those who are in community college. And our community colleges need to be supported even more. We need to be celebrated because it has saved a lot of young people. A lot of folks we know have been saved in the community college as they move forward. And it is one of those things that we have in California that in my mind gives me hope when I talk to young people about going to college. Everybody in California can go to college and get a degree. You know, it's amazing. It's amazing what it can do.
Thank you all for those thoughtful perspectives and conversations. We're going to continue part two. We are.